Next on CNS-TV News, they're scared, angry, and fed up. And now they're coming together to save their community. I'm Olivia Wolfson, and I'll have more coming up.
Travel Tuesday is here after the busiest travel weekend of the year. I'm Avery Newport, and I'll tell you how you can save and avoid scams.
Lace up your sneakers and hit the track. Girls are running all over Montgomery County. I'm Jesse Schwartz, and I'll tell you who they are and what they're doing up next. CNS-TV News starts now.
Juvenile crime in the DMV is at an all-time high. I'm Tulupe Ajayi, and we'll tell you how one city council is tackling the issue of kids and crime.
And looking to get away this holiday season, we'll bring you the best time to book. I'm Erin Burnett, and this is CNS-TV.
Residents from Prince George's County are growing concerned with what some are calling a youth crime crisis. CNS's Olivia Wolfson is at Bowie State University right now, where residents and community leaders are coming together to talk about how to tackle the issue. Olivia, what are you hearing?
That's right, guys. It's becoming a problem across the region and right here in PG County. Young people at the center of violent crimes. That's why the public was invited to Bowie State University tonight, where they'll be talking to county, state, and school officials about how to address the ongoing youth violence problem. Now, council member Ingrid Watson is hosting the public forum tonight, and she plans on introducing new bills that'll address things like gun violence prevention, juvenile justice reform, and parent accountability. Now, she also wants to know what the root of the problem is within her community.
It's very broad, and that's what we really need to sit down and talk about, because...
Now, Watson hopes after tonight that the public forum will garner enough attention and support that people will go down to Annapolis and testify in support for these bills. Now, the public forum will be held right here at the Student Center Ballroom from 6 to 8:30 tonight, and the public is highly encouraged to attend. Live from Bowie State University, I'm Olivia Wolfson.
And
back
youth
to you
crime.
Guys.
Thanks, Olivia. And youth crime is infiltrating Maryland's communities beyond Prince George's County. Last week, the Baltimore Police Department reported making over 200 arrests, including 18 juveniles for various crimes. Seven of those juveniles are between the ages of 12 and 15. Baltimore has seen a spike in juvenile crime in recent weeks as carjackings and a string of robberies plague neighborhoods. Frustrated residents are blaming current juvenile justice laws as the spike in crime intensifies. Some residents in Prince George's County have turned their frustration into a lawsuit. They say county police stormed their apartment without a warrant and shot their dog unprovoked. We do want to warn you, the footage you're about to see is quite graphic.
PGPD, you coming out or we coming in?
From the moment Prince George's County Police stepped through the doors of Erica Umana, Erica Arazo Sanchez, Dari Ama, and Brandon Cuevas.
I don't need a warrant, we got probable cause.
Maintenance, open the door. You take that issue with them.
Their lawyer, Malcolm Ruff, says those officers violated their Fourth Amendment rights.
The Fourth Amendment is very clear that the government shall not have the right to intrude on somebody's home unless they have a warrant or a clear exception to the warrant requirement.
In 2021, three Prince George's County officers were called to the apartment of these four roommates regarding a dog biting incident.
Put your handcuffs, you don't stop.
Because this is my house.
But Ruff says how they responded to the call was far from legal. Entering their home without a warrant and attempting to arrest Umana. As seen on body camera footage here, the roommates were pushed by officers, slammed to the floor and into the counters, and even had a taser pointed at them. And ultimately, when officers came in contact with the dog, they shot him in the back twice and tasered him, leaving the dog, Hennessy, paralyzed, eventually forcing his owners to put him down. Ruff says the damage that his clients have faced has been irreparable.
They have PTSD, depression, anxiety, sleeplessness, all kinds of horrific negative mental health effects.
This is why they have filed a $16 million lawsuit against the Prince George's County Police Department.
To send a message to other police officers that this type of malicious, unconscionable behavior, this brazen brutality will not be stood for. And if you commit these acts, you will be hit in your pockets. This has changed them for life. They will never be the same. They will never view life the same way. And that is an utter tragedy.
Prince George's County Police have not returned our requests for comment. Attorney Malcolm Ruff says the incident is not isolated. He claims the department condones allowing officers to commit similar violations.
A much happier tale in another part of the DMV tonight. A DC woman reunites with her French bulldog after her puppy was dognapped last weekend. An armed robber stole Tiffany Worthy's puppy, Hendrix, outside of her home on Saturday afternoon. Worthy started a GoFundMe page and asked for everyone's help on social media. Worthy told the police that she was in contact with someone who claimed that they had the dog, and police were able to investigate and bring the puppy back home. Deals, deals, deals. Cyber Week sales skyrocketed over the weekend, with consumer spending jumping 7.8%. Even with the economic uncertainty of a looming government shutdown, shoppers were not discouraged from finding the perfect gift this holiday season. Reuters estimates that online shoppers spent nearly $38 billion in just 5 days. And with the increased ease of online shopping, consumers could avoid the Black Friday crowds while still taking advantage of discounts on products across the market.
And the holiday deals don't end on Cyber Monday. Today is Travel Tuesday, and airlines also are trying to cash in on your spending. Avery Newport is at BWI Airport with tips on how to save if you're traveling. Avery, this Travel Tuesday thing isn't really a thing for some people, is it?
Yeah, Aaron, it's the day that airlines make deals to you. But you do have to be careful because it's pretty easy to get scammed if you're not careful. There are several websites that pose as legitimate travel sites that offer deals that seem too good to be true, and that's mostly because they are. They're scams. The first warning is to be careful where you book and what information you put out there. And sometimes the deals you get from legitimate websites aren't always the best deals for you either. Travel experts say sometimes it's just marketing. Passengers we talked to today said they don't rely on traveling Tuesdays for a deal.
I'm like always on Google flights, but not specifically around like a certain time of year or anything.
Now, here's some tips when you're looking for a good deal for traveling. First, you got to plan ahead. The farther out, the cheaper the price. Be flexible. Flying on Saturday, Tuesday, and Wednesday will get you much lower fares than any other day. Fly during dead times, when no one else wants to. Morning and night flights are generally much cheaper. Also, travel off-peak. Traveling on Christmas Day is cheaper than the days leading up to it, and many other days as well. And use alternate airports. Now, there are aggregator sites out there like Google Flights and Expedia that can help you with booking, but they don't always include discount airlines like Southwest. So, in short, plan ahead, shop around, be careful with your information, and be flexible. Reporting live at BWI Airport in Baltimore, I'm Avery Newport for CNS-TV, News. Back to you in the studio.
Sounds like really good advice. Thanks, Avery. If you would rather drive than catch a flight, or you need to fill up your gas tank, do it. Nationwide gas prices have dropped for 10 straight weeks. According to GasBuddy, the national average is down 26 cents from a month ago and 30 cents per gallon lower than a year ago. According to AAA, Maryland's average gas price says the current average for the regular is $3.24.
More accessible healthcare in Maryland. Governor Wes Moore announced today expanded access to contraceptive care across Maryland. In partnership with the Maryland Department of Health, Upstream USA will offer contraceptive care resources to healthcare providers. Maryland has one of the highest rates of unattended pregnancy in America, and many Maryland women live in areas which lack access to contraceptive methods. Governor Moore says the plan is about ensuring that contraception is treated like basic healthcare. Coming up on CNS-TV, the funeral of a beloved First Lady.
And with the cold weather here to stay, we'll tell you how you can shine a light on those wintertime blues.
My biggest takeaway would be that CNS is definitely a professional news environment, and I'm kind of being treated as such, so this is my first time reporting like that, so I'm pretty excited, and I know by the end of it, I'll be ready to launch my career.
more than anything, CNS is just, it's a really great learning opportunity. Every week we're presented with a new challenge. We have to tackle it together as a team, and something like that, it's just a really great positive experience for everyone, and that's why it's so important to me. When it all comes together beautifully and together, it's great. It's a great feeling because you know that everyone chipped in to do it.
When I never graduated from high school, I realized I wanted to go back to school because I didn't want to work these back-breaking jobs the rest of my life. With the help of my father and having my son, that was all the motivation that I needed to come back to school. I felt accomplished. It made me feel that I could take on whatever challenges life throws at you.
Find free adult education classes near you at finishyourdiploma.org.
Welcome back to CNS-TV. Today, a former First Lady honored. Hundreds gathered to pay their respects to Rosalynn Carter, who died at the age of 96 on November 19th. The crowd included her 99-year-old husband, former President Jimmy Carter, and a rare gathering of all living First Ladies. Today was the second day in a three-day series of events to honor the former First Lady ahead of the Wednesday funeral. Carter's coffin currently lies in the Jimmy Carter Presidential Library in the museum in Atlanta, Georgia. So those who in the DMV who may want to pay their respects must pay them from afar.
One of the three Palestinian college students shot on Saturday night in Vermont has been released from the hospital. The two other students are still hospitalized, one with a serious spinal injury who may be unable to use his legs again. The three students were home for Thanksgiving, going on a walk when they were shot. The suspected shooter pleaded not guilty to attempted second-degree murder charges as he is currently being held without bail. The families of the students say they're relieved that the suspect has been arrested.
Israel and Hamas agreed on extending the ceasefire by two more days. According to the Red Cross and the Israel Defense Forces, 12 hostages held in Gaza were released today. None of them were American. In exchange, Israel released 30 Palestinians, including 15 minors and 15 women. The first American hostage released by Hamas this weekend was 4-year-old Abigail Moore Ednan, who is an Israeli-American girl and the youngest American being held hostage.
For many, daylight savings time means shorter days and colder weather. But for millions of others, it brings on months-long struggles for mental health. CNS's Michael Levitsky details how it affects people and what can be done to treat it.
It kind of makes you feel exhausted mentally and emotionally.
Josiah Altshuler says this time of year is always the hardest.
It lasts about, I guess it's half the year.
And he's not alone. The American Psychiatric Association estimates 17 million Americans endure seasonal depression, caused by a decrease in sunlight after daylight savings. For Altshuler, being in school makes it even more of a challenge. The stress is already high with final exams around the corner.
At the end of fall semester, I'm usually just done with it, and that makes me struggle in spring semester.
The problem, of course, are days like this. Early afternoon, clouds in the sky, and the sun setting, all while people are indoors, either at work or in class. Very little outdoor time, but there are some remedies that you can take to brighten your days.
I really like the just how open it is in this room. There's sunlight from three out of the four directions.
Exercise, diet, and even light therapy devices like these are all recommendations to help people who have seasonal depression. Doctors say 15 minutes a day under a therapy light is all you need. Reporting from College Park, I'm Michael Levitsky.
Anyone that believes they are suffering from seasonal depression that hasn't had success with these strategies should consult with their doctor or a mental health professional. And for people looking to combat seasonal depression, getting exercise is one of the best solutions.
Athletes all around Maryland are getting their exercise on the court and on the field. Jesse Schwartz is up next with sports.
With the winter sports in full swing, the Xfinity Center is the place to be if you're a Terps fan. And a Maryland football player has secured his legacy in writing. Stay tuned for sports.
Eva Marie smoked 12,000 packs of cigarettes over 15 years. She quit, and now there's a new lung cancer screening that could save her life. You stop smoking, now start screening. No matter how much you smoked, early detection could save you. Talk to your doctor or learn more at savedbythescan.org.
With freezing cold weather moving into College Park, Terps fans are glad to be heading inside to watch some basketball.
Both the men and women will take the court this week, so Jesse Schwartz has the latest with sports.
Yeah, basketball season is charging down the lane, and the Terps take the court in just over an hour. They'll take the court in Xfinity one final time before the start of conference play. The Ryder Broncos head to College Park to play the Terps at 7 o'clock tonight. After losing three straight away from home, Maryland has come out on top in their last two games. Julian Reese, double-digit points in their last three games, and the Terps will look for their big to have another big game. As they look to stay unbeaten at the Xfinity Center, a record which dates back to the 2021 season, and our Michael Kersting is live at Maryland's Mecca. Michael, despite the slow start, the Terps have improved at the right time with conference play just about to start.
Oh, Maryland's Mecca? Jesse, I really like that one. Now, let me tell you something about Maryland's Mecca, Jesse. It might be a little bit bitter cold outside it, but once you step inside it, the heat gets turned all the way up. It's a heat that the Terps have been feeling over the last couple weeks, unexpected losses, week 3-point shooting, the whole lot. But the last two games against Towson and South Alabama, Kevin Willard's boys have really responded emphatically, dispatching both of them with ease. Here are the skipper's thoughts on the last two games.
I think we've made a lot of good strides. I thought we attacked the zone better. I thought we got better shots. We just have to get a little bit more comfortable of when to shoot against the zone. I think that's my biggest thing.
Now, while it's been Willard's offense that gets the real praise from everybody else, the pressure defense has been what's been getting the compliments from the chef. Here's the chef once again about that pressure defense and what else he would like to see before conference play comes up soon.
Just numbers-wise, it's been something that's a real strength of ours, so I want to keep building that and keep getting better at that. I think the rotations for me is just getting guys out there and getting them comfortable, because we're going to need everyone once Big Ten play comes.
Now, if those Towson and South Alabama games were any indication, the Terps should feel pretty good about going into this week. They gear up behind me to play the Bronx of Ryder University in just under an hour, and then they ship off to Bloomington to start Big Ten play against Khalil Ware, the 7-footer, and the Indiana Hoosiers this Friday night. Now, Jesse, the win tonight, if they get one, it'd be the 15th win at home in a row for the Terps, the 7th longest active streak in college basketball. What kind of chances are you giving them tonight?
Yeah, I mean, I think they've got it. It's quite a place to play. The Terps have great fans, and I haven't been to a game yet this season, but I am excited to go. You talked about them turning up the heat in the Xfinity Center, and I'm excited to break a sweat jumping up and down the student section. Thanks, Michael. And for the rest of Terps fans, they shouldn't stray too far from Xfinity either, as the women's head there tomorrow night. Maryland women have had a challenging start to the season, taking on two ranked opponents in number 1 South Carolina and number 11 UConn, both on the road and falling into the loss column. They also fell to Washington State, but have secured wins in the last two games. They will look to have a dominant performance at home against Niagara on Wednesday before conference play starts this weekend. And another team that looks like it's found its footing, Maryland football. They finished off the season hot, adding a 42-24 win over Rutgers to finish the regular season 7-5. A 7-5 record? Not the record fans will remember from this game, though. Quarterback Talia Tagovailoa now holds the all-time Big Ten passing record. Prior to the game, He needed 268 yards to slide into the number one spot, and he passed that by halftime. He finished the game with 11,256 passing yards, and his name has etched itself into the record books.
Well, for a guy that came here under the shadow of a huge last name to make his own mark here at Maryland, but also in the Big Ten, I think speaks volumes of the type of character that this kid has. And I'm really proud of what he's done in helping us elevate this program.
The Terps will look forward to a bowl berth and finding out their destination. For the third straight season, Maryland now has a winning record 3 in a row for the first time since 2001 to 2003. But another team in the DMV area, not seen a winning season in nearly 10 years. The Commanders are continuing to struggle this season. Only 4 wins and winless in their division, seeing them squarely at the bottom of the NFC East. After their Thanksgiving showdown, head coach Rivera got rid of his defensive coordinator, a move that is widely thought of as not enough to save his job. New owner Josh Harris has spoken publicly about making changes as soon as the season is finished. And for Washington fans, that season end might be the most exciting time to watch the team, on the stage, on draft night. Now guys, while DC football seems to continue to be in free fall, Maryland teams are trending up. What DMV team are you guys most excited to watch this winter?
Well, you know, I'm from Baltimore, so I'm going to rep the Ravens any chance I get.
I'm from much closer to Baltimore than I am to D.C., so I will also be taking Birdland all the way. But, yes. I mean, also, of course, the Terps will rock for them forever. So
right.
We'll do what we got to do. Ahead on CNS-TV, a unique twist on Giving Tuesday.
We'll show you a brand new easy way to give here in the DMV. But first, a look ahead at our bundle up forecast. Carl?
If you're just now waking up from your post-Thanksgiving nap, you may have missed Mother Nature teasing a winter wonderland. I'm Carl McManus, your forecast coming up after the break.
More than anything, CNS is just, it's a really great learning opportunity. Every week we're presented with a new challenge. We have to tackle it together as a team, and something like that, it's just a really great positive experience for everyone, and that's why it's so important to me. When it all comes together beautifully and together, it's great. It's a great feeling because you know that everyone chipped in to do it.
The black truck? Hey, Christina from accounting.
Yeah, hi.
Hey, I used to date a girl named Christina.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and then she dumped me for my best friend. You want to see some photos of them that I took?
I don't.
I thought we talked about this, buddy.
Buzzing over shared again?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to call a car.
That's a smart idea.
So, yeah, I know. That's why I did it.
Hey, you're going to get back to the top of the mountain.
Does that mean I'm going to get back with Christina?
No.
Oh.
No.
Mi mamá la deportaron. No sentía que tenía la motivación para seguir estudiando. Mi esposo es un gran apoyo para mí porque desde el principio él siempre me ha apoyado que yo regresara a la escuela. Mi hija y mi hijo son lo que a mí me hacen vivir. Las cosas que pensé que no podía lograr, lo estoy haciendo. Por eso le digo a todos que también ellos lo pueden lograr.
Encuentra clases gratis para adultos cerca de ti en completatudiploma.org.
We're still a few days away from December, but that hasn't stopped Frosty the Snowman from sending a few magic sprinkles our way.
You know what, Tulupe? I think it's giving sweater weather, like the kids say, but also, dare I say, Carl, snow.
Fingers crossed.
You better watch out, and I'm telling you why, starting with our current conditions. As you can see, 35 degrees right now, scattered flurries. If you woke up this morning seeing something falling from the sky, your eyes weren't mistaken. That was most likely snow. But hold on to your top hats because 26 mile per hour wind gusts, that may have been what caused Frosty the Snowman's hat to blow away. And we'll take a look next at tonight's conditions. It's getting even cooler, 21 degrees tonight. Mostly clear though, and those winds are calming down just a little bit, but still make sure you have a hold on your hat. Moving on to the radar. As you see, the radar is showing winds sweeping up into Maryland right now. That's why it's mostly cloudy for the next couple of days. And we'll keep it rolling, going on to the 5-day. temperatures steadily climbing a little bit as we get into the weekend. Thank goodness, it was very cold this morning. I had to bring out the scraper, get all the ice off my windshield this morning. You probably did too. But as we get into the weekend, some rain. Not cold enough for the snow. 30% chance of rain, 80% chance of rain on Friday, 30% chance of rain on the weekend. So bundle up, grab your coats, and while the winter weather is starting to creep in, you can probably hold off on decking the halls with boughs of holly for now.
All I have to say is let it snow, let it snow, let it snow, and let that cancel whatever classes it chooses to.
I don't know. Right now it's kind of giving slush, so yeah. Fingers crossed for more snow later.
All right. Well, thanks, Carl. With December just around the corner, Capitol Hill is getting in the holiday spirit.
Plus, practice makes perfect. Coming up on CNS-TV, we'll tell you about a group of girls who are building their confidence and endurance.
My name's Olivia Wolfson, and I'm a senior. And my biggest takeaway would be that CNS is definitely a professional news environment, and I'm kind of being treated as such. So this is my first time reporting like that, so I'm pretty excited. And I know by the end of it, I'll be ready to launch my career.
Fast and furious. Streets closed down all around Montgomery County as elementary schoolers took to the roads to run a 5K. Girls on the Run had thousands of girls head to the starting line and run the race they've been training for all fall.
A lot of energy, excitement, as more than 5,000 people lined up for a race.
And seeing them when, like, their faces when they cross the finish line is pretty amazing.
Where the goal was more than placing first.
The program is great in giving them that drive and giving them that ability to move and also giving them that confidence booster that they need.
This is the Girls on the Run 5K. Elementary school girls trained after school all fall to get ready for the run and life.
And then they learn to push themselves, and I see them going after things they couldn't do and achieving their lap goals each week. And then I see them applying it in the classroom.
And Allison has seen evidence of that during the runs, when young girls push themselves beyond what they thought they could do.
She's willing to go alone. She's willing to go for what she wants, but she's not forgetting about her teammates, and she's cheering every single one of them on.
It's really all about you can accomplish anything that you set your mind to.
The coaches are often teachers at the school.
That's why I wanted to get involved as a coach, because I knew what it did for me as a participant.
Many who participated in this exact program themselves when they were growing up, taking the lessons they learned and passing them on.
Growing girls' confidence is a really big thing, and teaching girls to support each other.
You're coaching the whole person, you're coaching the whole girl, and you're teaching the whole person.
Which means for this race, there is no finish line.
It's great just seeing a girl in today's world knowing, like, she is enough and she can do this.
Jesse Schwartz, CNS TV News.
And not just enough, but also influential. Many of these girls will look back on this experience as the start of their running career. Many others will hang up their sneakers, but carry the lessons they learned with them for the rest of their lives.
Oh, Christmas tree. Sorry, guys. No, like, I can't sing. Well, moments ago, the Capitol Christmas tree lit up, signaling the start of the holiday season. Take a look at this footage from the 2022 tree lighting. This annual tradition honors a different state each year, with the National Park Service providing a tree from a national forest, which is then decorated with handmade ornaments from the tree's home state. This year, the tree is a 63-foot Norway spruce from West Virginia's Monongalia National Forest. It will be on display in front of the Capitol building from now until January 1st. To see the tree, and for those looking for the perfect holiday picture the lights will be on from dusk until 11 p.m. every evening. It's Giving Tuesday, and here's a unique way to give in the DMV. You've seen vending machines, but how about with gifts for people in need? These giving machines make it easy to give, allowing people to donate with a push of a button, sending items to communities in need around the world. The giving machines are by the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints that allow donations to give clean water, goats, meals, toys, and more to those in need. So if you're feeling charitable this holiday season, this is an opportunity to give. I'm not sure about the goats. I don't know if that was a typo or what, but I'm here for it.
You never know who needs a goat. You know what? A gift is a gift.
Right.
And honestly, that's a very cool giving tree, and it's making me super in the holiday spirit. So I'm excited to give and to get some gifts this year.
Right.
It's all about the giving. I'm really excited to see the Christmas tree get lit. How about you, Jesse?
I'm excited for the temperatures to not be 25 degrees, gotta say. But I am excited to get in the Christmas spirit.
I'm only okay with it if it's going to be snow, but we'll see.
Right.
But make sure you check us out online at cnsmaryland.org and follow us on Twitter at CNSMD.
You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/MarylandCNS and on YouTube at CNS Maryland.
Thank you for joining us. Have a good evening.